Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Freedom to Win, a Cold War story of the courageous hockey team that fought the Soviets for the soul of its people and Olympic gold. By Ethan Scheiner. Narrated by Tom Beyer. Prologue. Replay of a Lost War. March 21st, 1969. Three small-town men and their hockey teammates from the little country of Czechoslovakia found themselves in the midst of a scene unlike any they had ever encountered. When Yaroslav Holik, his younger brother Yiri, and their friend since childhood Jan Suchy took to the ice in Johanneshov Stadium in Stockholm, Sweden, a crowd of thousands engulfed them, shaking the arena with a mad roar for Czechoslovakia's hockey squad. In the stands, people chanted, "Revenge for August 68!" As the players looked around, they saw fans holding banners supporting their team. One in particular stood out. "You send tanks, we bring goals." This was no normal sporting event. Just months earlier, the Soviet Union, the Russians, had invaded their country. Yaroslav, Yiri, Jan, and all of Czechoslovakia watched as each day, piece by piece, their freedoms disappeared. In desperation, Czechs and Slovaks searched for a sign that the Soviets had not stolen everything from them. Powerless against thousands of tanks and 500,000 troops, they knew they could never take down the soldiers in a military battle. But what if they defeated the Soviets in a different kind of fight? What if they could show that even though Moscow held them physically captive, there were freedoms that it could never take from them? They turned to their country's heroes, the representatives of Czechoslovakia's national hockey team. The task for these men? Nothing less than bringing defeat to the greatest hockey squad on the planet. The Soviet Union had won the previous 6 world titles, including the last 2 Olympic Games. Nevertheless, everywhere the Czechoslovak players went, people told them, "We don't care what else you do, just beat the Russians." For the people of Czechoslovakia, the March 1969 World Ice Hockey Championships in Stockholm turned into a battlefield. On March 21st, 7 months to the day since Soviet tanks first appeared on their streets, Czechs and Slovaks, through Yaroslav, Yiri, Jan, and their teammates, could finally fight back. By the end of the evening, the Czechoslovakia-Soviet rivalry would be all anyone at the tournament talked about. The front-page headlines in the Western press described it aptly: hate match. Alexander Dubček, Czechoslovakia's leader, would describe it as much more. It was a replay of a lost war. For years to come, people would speak of that week in Stockholm when Czechoslovakia's hockey players spit on the communist coat of arms that adorned their jerseys, took out their anger on the ice in ways that no one had ever seen in a sporting event, and inspired the people of their demoralized country. The inspiration would shape the lives of a new generation. Hockey players 29 years later and thousands of miles from home would kiss a new coat of arms and try to achieve the one thing that eluded the heroes of 1969. Through it all, the ice warriors fought for far more than just hockey victories. They battled to show that the people of their long overlooked country had the freedom to win. Part 1. From Winter to Spring.
Lenka interrupts. In the West, no one knows anything about Prague. They try to forget Prague after they betrayed us in 1938. Do you know about 1938?
The Munich Accord?
Accord. Does accords mean agreement? But we did not agree to anything. Mnichovska Zrada. That is what we call it. The Munich Betrayal. And because of this betrayal, we are forgotten. Our country is forgotten. Prague is forgotten. And who cares that it is the most beautiful city in Europe? So we need people like you to help the world rediscover our city and our country, and to protect it against the Russians.
Simon Moore, Prague Spring. Chapter 1. The Butcher Shop on Thin Ice. In 1942, in a little town in what was once known as Czechoslovakia, a 20-year-old man named Jaroslav Holik opened a butcher shop. In the years to come, he and his family put their hearts and souls into the shop. It would become the center of their world. The young man could hardly have chosen a more difficult place and time to open a new business than the town of Brod in 1942. Just a few months earlier, in late September 1941, Reinhard Heydrich, a high-ranking German official, had arrived in the Czech capital of Prague, seemingly straight out of central casting. 6 feet 3 inches tall, with neatly slicked blonde hair and pale blue eyes, Heydrich personified the ideal Aryan. Adorned with nicknames such as the Blonde Beast, the Hangman, Himmler's evil genius, and the young evil god of death, Heydrich had helped organize the Kristallnacht reign of terror on German and Austrian Jews, and served as the official planner of the Final Solution, the Nazi plan for the genocide of the Jewish people. Heydrich instantly lived up to all of his nicknames, executing more than 140 people within 5 days of his arrival in the Czech lands. To many, Heydrich's landing in Prague felt sudden, but really, it had been centuries in the making. Today, Brod sits in the very center of the Czech Republic, almost exactly equidistant between the country's two biggest cities, about 70 miles from the capital, Prague, to the northwest, and Brno to the southeast. But once upon a time, the area was all forest-covered frontier. Settlement began in the mid-1200s with the discovery of silver ore deposits. Soon, German settlers made up the majority of the population, leading the town to name itself Niemetzki Brod, German Ford, in 1308. Over the years, the town was visited by numerous calamities, from plagues to fires to floods. But the greatest threat arose because of its location in the middle of the continent. One after another, the powers of Europe sought to hold sway over the region, and by the late 19th century, it had become part of the Austro-Hungarian Empire. After intense lobbying by Czech and Slovak nationalists, and the collapse of the Austro-Hungarian Empire at the end of the First World War, in 1918, the Allies supported the creation of a new country, Czechoslovakia, out of a small part of the lands that had been under the Empire's control. Czechoslovakia was immediately among the world's most industrialized countries and established a parliamentary democracy. In Brod, jubilant citizens marched through the streets to celebrate the establishment of the free Czechoslovak state. As they did, they tore down all Austrian signs, pictures of the Austrian emperor, and any other symbols of the imperial state, which they burned in a huge bonfire in the main square. But Czechoslovakia faced a major problem. The western corner of the country jutted nearly 150 miles into Germany, with German lands to the north and the south. And ethnic Germans made up nearly a quarter of Czechoslovakia's population. As a result, Czechoslovakia included numerous German-speaking enclaves, especially in the area surrounding Brod. Over time, German nationalists in Czechoslovakia increasingly demanded that their border regions be made part of the homeland. And once Hitler rose to power in the 1930s, Germany threatened to use force to accommodate them. Desperate to prevent war across Europe, in 1938, Britain and France signed the Munich Agreement with Germany, thus giving Hitler effective control over large swaths of Czechoslovakia. As he prepared to give Germany much of what it wanted, British Prime Minister Neville Chamberlain explained the decision to his people over the radio. "How horrible, fantastic, incredible it is that we should be digging trenches and trying on gas masks here because of a quarrel in a faraway country between people of whom we know nothing." Czechoslovakia was not even invited to the negotiations over its lands and felt betrayed by the Western powers, all the more so because it had a military alliance with France. This would not be the last time that the world abandoned Czechoslovakia. On March 15, 1939, German military forces entered the Czech lands. News of the invasion arrived in Brod first thing that morning, and heavily armed German soldiers entered the town at 1 p.m. In Jihlava, a town with a large German population 16 miles to the south, the residents celebrated the new arrivals. But in Brod, where the Hussite Wars had driven out much of the German population in the 15th century, the mood was largely one of indifference, and only a few representatives of the city came to greet the invaders. In the following weeks, that mood changed. Posters started to appear all over town, in German and broken Czech, listing new ordinances for the residents, most notably a nightly curfew. Brod was permitted to maintain its own mayor, but Germans controlled the rest of the administration and opened an office for the Gestapo, the Nazi secret police. Over time, the Germans sent hundreds of thousands of Czechs to concentration camps. But at the beginning, the Nazis showed greater restraint than they demonstrated elsewhere in Europe because of their desire to mobilize the Czech population for the German war effort. Eventually, though, Hitler grew impatient with what he saw as overly lenient treatment of the Czechs by his deputies. In September 1941, he sent in Heydrich, one of his favorite lieutenants, to whip the country into submission. Appropriately fearing for its country's fate under the rule of the Nazi that Adolf Hitler affectionately called the Man with the Iron Heart, in the late spring of 1942, the Czechoslovak resistance assassinated Heydrich. Hitler immediately ordered devastating reprisals. German forces killed more than 1,300 Czechs, and in June, entirely eliminated two helpless villages. It was at this very time, as the threat of violence from German forces swirled around him, that young Jaroslav Holik decided to carve out a new life for himself. Earlier in the year, he had convinced the beautiful Vera Kasparova to marry him. On August 3, 1942, as Nazi terror rained down upon the country, Yaroslav and Viera's first child was born. They named him Yaroslav, just like his father. Given the utter madness that surrounded his birth, perhaps the Holiks should have anticipated that the child would grow up to be wild. As if marriage, a new child, and the Nazi occupation weren't enough, in 1942, Yaroslav Sr. also decided to open a butcher shop. The decision had actually been made by his father, who said to his son,
"Look, there is an open butcher shop. Rent it and show me what you can do."
Meat was the family business. Yaroslav's father was a butcher, so was his brother. And even though little more than 10,000 people lived in Brot during the war, the town had enough demand to accommodate multiple butchers. Yaroslav and Viera's shop sat in a nearly perfect location on Horní Street, a three-block-long, narrow, gray brick lane lined with local businesses. Horní Street led diagonally into the beautiful town square, which was surrounded on four sides by distinctive two-story Renaissance and Baroque houses with decorated gables. In the square's northeast corner, a centuries-old church tower allowed visitors to view the quiet town and the vast countryside beyond. By the time Yaroslav and Viera wed in 1942, the German occupation had hit Viera's family hard. Viera had been born in 1922 to a woman who worked on a nearby farm and died after childbirth. A kind Brod couple, Robert and Marie Horak, adopted the little girl and brought her to live with them. Robert had long been deeply concerned about the plight of the poor and the grave inequality he saw around him. He became a devoted member of the Communist Party and even served under the party banner as Brod's deputy mayor. In 1941, the Germans carried out a series of arrests of communists in the town. The occupiers executed the editor of the communist newspaper for his resistance activities and shipped Horak off to Buchenwald concentration camp. Viera spent the next 4 years caring for her ill mother and waiting for news of her father. The period following Yaroslav and Viera's wedding, the opening of the butcher shop, and the birth of little Yaroslav proved no less terrifying. In 1943, the Germans took complete control of Brod's administration and established German as the town's official language. Former officers in the Czechoslovak army organized resistance groups, which the Gestapo quickly crushed, putting to death two of their members and sending others off to concentration camps, some never to return. The Holik's worries only grew after their second son, Yiri, was born on July 9, 1944. Allied air raids focused on a local airfield and dropped bombs on the town, which damaged buildings and killed four schoolchildren. Life in the butcher shop didn't feel much safer. For the rest of his life, Yaroslav Jr. would vividly remember German soldiers confiscating smoked meats. Viera hid the boy under a table, holding his head down so he couldn't see, but he never forgot the pounding of the soldiers' heavy boots as they shouted in German at his father. The Holiks had to confront a series of difficult questions in their shop. Will we have enough? Will we have the products that the Germans want? Should we sell to them? Will we have enough for our regular customers? Will the Gestapo come take our store? Then toward the end of the war, when local partisans came to buy products, the question became, if we sell to them, will someone rat us out? One day, a Czech partisan bought sausages and salami. Several hours later, Viera saw German soldiers carrying the man away, dead. Nevertheless, needing to make a living, Yaroslav Sr. and Viera threw themselves into the shop. Yaroslav Sr. lacked both a formal education and the glad-handing panache of a typical salesman, but he had good sense and simply outworked everyone else. A disciple of Dale Carnegie and his book, How to Win Friends and Influence People, the young man became a skilled negotiator, able to get products and rent services and space at good prices. Viera, who had previously worked in a hairdressing salon in Prague, handled sales. The Holik butcher shop not only survived, but even became popular. With the tide turning against the Germans in early 1945, a civilian resistance group in Brod formed to fight back. In early May, as Czechs in Prague spontaneously rose up to fight their occupiers, civilians in Brod revolted as well. In response, German forces carried out brutal countermeasures, including executing Brod locals. The repression continued until May 8th, when the Germans fled, fearing the approaching Soviet Red Army. On May 9th, Soviet forces liberated the town. Only then did the people of Brod learn just how cruel the occupiers had truly been as they uncovered mass graves of tortured patriots. In the weeks after the liberation, the Holiks received a welcome shock. Viera's father, Robert, abruptly appeared on the doorstep of the butcher shop, thin as a pole and weighing less than 90 pounds. Many Germans had lived in the area around Brod prior to the war, and Grandpa Horak had learned quite a bit of the language. His knowledge of German had helped him survive in Buchenwald. A die-hard communist, Horak was grateful to the Soviets for their part in freeing him and his country from Germany's clutches. In truth, U.S. Army forces had entered Czechoslovakia by early May 1945, prepared to support the effort to defeat the Germans. However, American President Harry Truman and General Dwight Eisenhower wanted to avoid a showdown with Soviet leader Joseph Stalin, who saw Eastern Europe as his payment for the millions of Soviet soldiers who had died fighting the Nazis. The American leadership ordered its forces to stay back, thus giving the Soviets time to carry out the liberation. It was a decision that many leaders on the U.S. side came to regret, and that millions in Eastern Europe, including the Holiks, came to despise. Once again, Czechoslovakia's geography, this time its shared eastern border with the USSR, proved to be a curse. But in the immediate aftermath of the war, the people of Brod thought little about that. Instead, they focused on rebuilding. Wanting no more to do with its long-gone German heritage, the town changed its name to Havlíčkův Brod, Havlíček's Ford, honoring local 19th-century writer Karel Havlíček Borovský. Residents volunteered nearly 100,000 hours to remove damaged buildings and vehicles, repair and repave roads and squares, and restart city gas distribution. 1 year after liberation, visitors were hard-pressed to find any clear evidence of war damage in the town. The town's population was growing, which was great news for the young entrepreneurial family. Yaroslav Sr. and Viera worked from dawn to dusk in the shop, and the boys helped whenever they were needed. Yet money was hardly plentiful for the young couple, both just 24 years old, with two small children. They lived in a small town with a population now close to 12,000, in a small country of just 12 million that was struggling in the post-war world. The kids had little beyond the bare necessities. Each had two pairs of shorts, one pair of cloth pants, and a disgusting pair of sweatpants. Yaroslav Sr. and Vera poured their earnings back into the business, purchasing machinery and devices to expand into a large meat cannery, the first of its kind in Brod. Even still, they didn't put every crown, Czechoslovakia's currency, into the shop. For Christmas, in 1946, they gave four-year-old Yaroslav Jr. a gift that would shape the rest of his life. His first ice skates, a detachable pair that affixed to the bottoms of his boots. The gift was a rare luxury for the Holik family. When it came time to exchange presents that year, Yaroslav's father handed his wife a hat. It was the very hat he'd given her the year before, which he re-wrapped so she would have something to open. It was the same hat that he would give her the next year as well. When the Holiks awoke on Christmas morning, the scene was bleak. On the first floor, their one-room kitchen, living, and dining space was also used by the butcher shop, so the wooden floor was usually covered in meat mess and grease. Vera got up at 3 a.m. three times a week to scrub it, with only a wood stove to warm her. Upstairs, they had just a single bedroom in which they all slept. During the winter, they used a single heating drum to warm the apartment and to heat water for bathing. It had no separate bathroom. Instead, a single toilet sat in the hallway. The toilet space was so poorly lit that Yuri avoided relieving himself in the house because of his fear of the dark. Little Yaroslav's Christmas gift was part of the effort Yaroslav Sr. and Vera made to create a joyful childhood for their boys. Despite the poverty of the time, life for the Holik kids looked a lot like that for children elsewhere. With their parents working all day, they were able to mostly just run free when not at school. Somehow, even in small-town Czechoslovakia, kids got their hands on magazines from the West, filled with stories of exotic lands like Texas. At night, they hid under the covers, reading these magazines by flashlight. In the summer, they created elaborate maps of the town, wherein the local creek became the Amazon. So it was for the young Holik boys. Brod covered only a total of 25 square miles, markedly smaller than American towns such as Middlebury, Vermont, and Bend, Oregon, and even a shade smaller than tiny Oshkosh, Wisconsin. The Holik boys, with their closely shorn tow heads, could be seen running all around town throughout the year. Although Yaroslav towered over his just 2 years younger brother, there was little doubt that they were siblings. As little boys, both were so skinny that their ribs stuck out when they frolicked in their swimsuits at the lake. The kids in Brod especially loved winter games. On cold winter evenings, they poured water onto the streets so they could get up early the next day and slide around town on makeshift sleds. But the older Holik brother yearned to do something else on the ice. When he opened his new skates on Christmas Day, Yaroslav Jr. could not contain his excitement. Brod contained numerous ponds of varying sizes, some just tiny patches of water. Yaroslav Sr. took his older boy out to one such patch behind a nearby park and taught him how to skate. From that day on, whenever young Yaroslav had a free moment in the winter, he went from pond to pond, skating to his heart's content. 2 years later, when Yuri was 4, Viera started making Yaroslav bring his little brother with him. Until the boys were old enough for school, on winter mornings the parents headed off early to work, then around lunchtime took the boys to the pond. Most often, Yaroslav Jr. and Yiri went to Chihlar, brickworker, pond, so called because it sat by the brickwork factory. The pond sat nestled near Vrishovica, just outside of Brod, where Vier's parents lived. In the winter, the pond typically froze over by the end of November and remained frozen through the end of February. But the first signs of ice were hardly reliable. The neighborhood children were largely unsupervised, and as the surface began to solidify, they all went out to test it. From time to time, one of the kids took a step too many, the thin surface collapsed, and the child fell into the icy water. No one ever drowned, but many had to run home to change clothes. As the temperature turned colder, the kids watched with fascination as ice makers cut big chunks from the frozen pond for the local brewery. Once the adults left, the Holik boys would jump onto floating ice sheets, pretending that they were Inuits. With all the kids skating around, the ice became chipped and uneven, so the Holik boys turned their grandparents' old metal tub into a Zamboni. They filled the tub with water, dragged it down to the pond, and poured it onto the ice to smooth out the surface. Yaroslav Jr. loved his time at the pond, but complained about having to bring his brother.
"Why do I have to tie his shoelaces and watch over him?"
Yiri followed his brother around on the ice until around 6 p.m. when their parents came to get them. As she picked up the boys, Viera always girded herself, ready to hear the latest from other parents about her older son's poor behavior. From the earliest age, Yaroslav Jr. drove his parents to distraction. Much like the neighborhood crusty elderly man who knew better than everybody else, he never hesitated to let anyone within earshot know his opinion. The other kids nicknamed him Old Timer, Stare. People with big mouths often find themselves in conflict with others, and the Holiks saw their firstborn starting fights at a young age, even with children older and bigger than he was. Yaroslav Sr. was beside himself.
"You jackass, why do you have to fight with everyone? Just look at your brother. He smiles, and everything is good."
When he started attending school, Yaroslav Jr. made life miserable for his teachers, whom he talked back to on a regular basis. He was a natural leader in the classroom and directed his followers to join him in causing a general ruckus. They hid under their desks to play blackjack and invented new games, such as seeing who could spit through the classroom window and come closest to nailing the horse that carried the town's mail. Corporal punishment was the norm in Brod schools at the time, so Yaroslav found himself getting smacked repeatedly by his teachers, but it was his mother's lectures that he most feared. In the house, Viera handled academics and had to suffer through reports at parent-teacher conferences that not only was Yaroslav performing poorly on his schoolwork, he was also constantly in trouble. Yaroslav usually argued with her, but once she started haranguing him, his eyes glazed over and he felt his mind melting. He decided to take steps to reduce the torture. Each student had a special notebook in which teachers recorded students' grades and noted disciplinary issues. As Yaroslav racked up the punishments, he got himself a second notebook where many of his worst citations would get listed. When his parents asked to see the notebook, he only showed them the first book, so they never learned of half his shenanigans. Yaroslav developed such a reputation that when Yiri entered the school that his older brother attended, one teacher recoiled.
"You are Holik's brother? Jesus Christ, what an ordeal this is going to be."
But in reality, Yiri couldn't have been less like his brother. Yaroslav Jr. had inherited his father's fiery temper, but everyone described Yiri as more like the sweet-tempered Viera. Whereas Yaroslav ran from one place to the next, Yiri strolled. At times, Yaroslav wished he could borrow the piece that seemed part of his younger brother's inner nature, but he quickly became infuriated at the thought of staying so still. The younger boy followed instructions and did well in school. Whenever she looked at her sweet little boy, Viera's heart melted. She told Yiri that all it took was a smile and everyone fell in love with him. So it was that when Viera came to pick her boys up from the pond, she could always expect to hear complaints about Yaroslav. But when both boys had been skating together for about a year, she began to hear something else as well. People of all ages were awestruck by her son. Not Yaroslav. It was Yiri that everyone gawked at. At no more than 5 years old, Viera's baby glided around the ice with extraordinary grace and speed. No one had ever seen anything quite like it, and it made an impression on an important person in the town. Brod had a rich tradition of hockey, going back well before World War II. In the early years after the war, kids played pickup hockey on any pond that would freeze. In 1949, when Yaroslav and Yiri were 7 and 5 years old, the Holik boys began to notice a gray-haired man in his 50s watching them play. The man was Yaroslav Dad Tomanek, who worked in the local revenue service office but was also the area's godfather of youth hockey, serving as team organizer, manager, treasurer, and occasional coach. In the years that followed, none of the kids could think of a time that he was missing from Brod's Kotlina rink, even if it was freezing or snowing. He never played hockey and had never been on skates, but he loved children and knew what sports meant to them. Tomanek didn't know the first thing about coaching, but he focused on one core principle. He forced the boys to skate while looking at him. He held up various numbers of fingers and instructed the skaters to tell him how many he was holding up. If they looked down, he gave them a quick smack with a stick. Because of this one drill, the boys learned to see everything around them on the ice while also controlling the puck. Kotlina was an open-air, natural ice rink surrounded by wooden boards. As was common throughout the country, the base of the skating surface was concrete, which was sprayed down with hose water that turned to ice when the temperature dropped low enough. When resurfacing was required, volunteers dragged barrels of hot water all over the ice. There was a small bleacher stand next to the rink, but many fans stood on snowbanks to watch. An old house abutted the rink and provided miserable, cramped changing rooms floored with wooden planks. Upon entering, players needed to immediately start a fire in the heater or they would freeze while changing. At 7 years old, Yaroslav Jr. caught Tomanek's eye, and with the prodding of Yaroslav Sr., decided to join the organized hockey team. The boy had to look after his brother while his parents worked, so the Holiks insisted that Yiri also join the squad as one of its youngest members. From the beginning, they were joined by one other boy Yuri's age. Jan Suchy was born in Brod on October 10, 1944, 3 months after Yuri. When Jan was born, both his parents worked at the local hospital. His 20-year-old mother, Jarmila, was a cook, and his 28-year-old father, František, drove the ambulance. František rarely talked about his work, and in fact was rarely home at all. Every day after work, he returned to the apartment, changed out of his work clothes, and headed to one of his two favorite pubs, where he hung out and played cards with a group of friends. The routine there was always the same: a pack of cigarettes, 3 beers, and 4 rums. The Suchys lived near the hospital, about half a mile due east of the Holiks, in an apartment building nicknamed the Pigsty, Prasichak, because it used to house pigs. Their apartment had a kitchen and a single bedroom in which they all slept. Cash was extremely tight, and they had to scrimp to be able to afford anything beyond the necessities. Despite the lack of money and the close quarters, František and Jarmila got along well, and Jan never once heard his parents fight. Each morning during the winter, Jarmila dropped little Jan off with a lunch at a local frozen pond, and he spent the day there playing on the ice with other boys from the neighborhood. When the boys got hungry, they built a fire out of twigs to heat their food and then continued playing. When Jan was just 4 years old, the bigger kids taught him how to skate. He didn't have his own skates, but he begged the other kids to let him play hockey with them. The big kids set him up as the goalie, having him stand in the scoring area in his regular walking shoes. They shot hard, but somehow the little boy didn't flinch. The kids didn't have much beyond their clothes to cover themselves, but they did make protective hockey gear out of whatever they could find. They stole any materials that might be turned into equipment and brought them to Jan's mother, who sewed everything together. Thanks to František's work at the hospital, Jan had ready access to a huge store of cotton balls, which he stuffed into his father's big winter gloves to catch pucks in the goal. After begging his father throughout the start of the winter season, little Jan got his first skates for Christmas in 1948, the same detachable kind Jiří also received that year. To the little Suchy boy, there was no greater feeling than flying around the ice. In general, František Suchy gave his son little attention until one day when he went to pick the boy up from the pond. František had been a soccer player for Brod and appreciated real athleticism. As he arrived to bring 5-year-old Jan home, he couldn't believe what he saw. His son raced around the ice as fast as any of the older boys and played hockey with them as an equal. In a town as small as Brod, František knew Dad Tomanek, and he signed his boy up to play with the group at Kotlina. Jan leaped at the chance to play more seriously. When the kids learned that practices ran early in the morning, 6-year-old Suchy was the only one from his class to sign up. Jiří and Jan were the same age, but they could not have been more different. Little Jan's thick, dark brown locks stood in sharp contrast to Jiří's blonde hair. Whereas Jiří's constantly smiling, boyish face gave him a cherubic image, Suchy's more angular features made him appear older than he actually was, and his smirk left those around him wondering what hijinks he had up his sleeve. Jan was tall and skinny, while Jiří was just small all over, leading Suchy to refer to him as runt, mnyaus. Yuri quickly got to work figuring out a nickname that he could throw back. He finally came up with Soshka, a play on Suhi's last name that translates to dry tree, a reference to how skinny and weak Jan appeared. The younger Holik boy later grew to be a stocky 5 feet 11 inches tall, but Suhi never stretched above 5'9", and even though he grew stronger and more muscled, everyone called him Soshka for the rest of his life. The behavior of the two boys contrasted even more than their physical appearances. Everyone knew Yuri for his happy-go-lucky disposition, his excellent behavior, and the fact that he did as he was told by his teachers and coaches. Suhi, meanwhile, was a completely different story. Soshka didn't mind mixing it up with other kids and simply refused to follow the rules. When the circus came to town, a young Jan skipped school to shovel sawdust in exchange for free tickets. He developed a reputation for his mischief, such as well-planned heists of local farmers' strawberries, apples, and watermelons, or sneakily filching fish from a breeding pond. And though Suhi loved hockey and played to win at all costs, he refused to follow his coach's instructions. Despite all these differences, Runt and Soshka quickly bonded as the youngsters of the team. Yuri was the only person Jan had ever met who could outskate him, while Yuri quickly realized that Suhi was by far the most naturally talented of all the young hockey players he had seen. Each morning in the winter, long before the sun rose, the two met in front of the local painter's cottage and set out together for the arena. Already in their gear, they would immediately clean the ice and get to work. Training was difficult. As soon as nightly temperatures hit freezing, Yaroslav Sr. yanked his groggy boys out of bed long before the sun could rise and possibly thaw the ice. As he shouted at them, Yaroslav Jr. and Yuri begged to stay in bed, but their father had plans for them. A 5 a.m. wake-up, a quick breakfast, and then the boys took off for the half-mile walk to Kotlina for 6 a.m. practice. Ordinarily, the walk might have been quick, but since the youth teams weren't permitted in the locker rooms, they had to carry all their very heavy gear, skates, pads, sticks, to and from the rink. After practice, the boys stopped at the butchery, where Yaroslav Sr. gave them each a piece of salami or sausage. It was hard to get quality hockey equipment in 1950s Czechoslovakia, especially out in the boonies of Brod. In particular, little was available in young kids' sizes, so everyone had to get creative. One of the regulars at the Holik butcher shop was a carpenter and cabinet maker named Maresh. When Yuri was just 5 years old, the little boy carefully hid away one of the sharp butcher knives, cut off a few slices of dry salami, and made a secret visit to see the man. "Mr. Maresh, here is some salami. Please make me a hockey stick." Before you knew it, the little boy had himself several sticks. For protective gear, Yaroslav Sr. commandeered sheet metal from local factories, which he used to construct pads. Viera handcrafted protection from random pieces of plywood and stitched together padded pants. Still, even with the makeshift protection, it was incredibly painful when the boys got hit by the puck, and their elbows were constantly swollen. None of the boys' families was rolling in money, but life was good. The boys had their hockey. The Holiks had their butcher shop. And then the communists stepped in. In March 1946, early in the year that Yaroslav Jr. received his first skates, British statesman Winston Churchill traveled to the United States to talk about the part of the world where the Holiks lived. After the war, the Soviet Union and its clients in the region employed a range of tactics, from rigging elections and threatening force to outright violence, to ensure the rise of communist regimes throughout much of Central and Eastern Europe. On March 5th, at Westminster College in Fulton, Missouri, Churchill, who had led Britain throughout the war, spoke passionately about the threat.
"An iron curtain has descended across the continent. Behind that line lie all the capitals of the ancient states of Central and Eastern Europe. Warsaw, Berlin, Prague, Vienna, Budapest, Belgrade, Bucharest, and Sofia, all these famous cities and the populations around them lie in what I must call the Soviet sphere, and all are subject in one form or another not only to Soviet influence, but to a very high and in some cases increasing measure of control from Moscow. The communist parties, which were very small in all these eastern states of Europe, have been raised to preeminence and power far beyond their numbers, and are seeking everywhere to obtain totalitarian control."
Yaroslav Jr. knew nothing about the speech and had only heard the name Churchill in passing, but the former prime minister was very familiar with the Holik's little country. The most positive words in the address came when he noted that Czechoslovakia remained the one true democracy in the region. Prior to the war, Czechoslovakia had been the most democratic country in Eastern Europe. On May 26, 1946, nearly 3 months after Churchill's speech, the country held free and fair parliamentary elections. Czechoslovakia's communists were the big winners, taking 38% of the vote, by far the most for any party. It was no surprise that the communists performed so well. In 1946, life was still difficult in Czechoslovakia, which was struggling to rise from the ashes of the war. People faced a deteriorating economy, severe shortages of all goods, and high unemployment. They remembered that historically, the country's communists had tried to work within the democratic system, that capitalist countries had abandoned Czechoslovakia before the war, and that Czechoslovak communists had fought hard against the Germans. It also didn't hurt that it had ultimately been the communist-led USSR that liberated the country. Following the election, the Communist Party formed a coalition government that sought to address the country's economic crisis. It was not immediately clear how much things would change with the Communist Party in power, but there were ominous signs. The communists now controlled the country's police, military, agriculture, and propaganda. In addition, the government took steps to control large-scale businesses, which instantly affected people across the country. The Holiks saw the results immediately, as the government took over the Vesely textile company in Brod, which employed 900 people. On the whole, though, the new policies didn't appear too radical, and the government seemed open to working with the capitalist West. When the U.S. began preliminary discussions on the Marshall Plan, which would offer massive economic aid to help European countries rebuild after the war, Czechoslovakia's government announced in July 1947 that it would participate. But the Soviets grew worried about Czechoslovakia drawing too close to the West. Stalin immediately summoned Clement Gottwald, Czechoslovakia's prime minister and Communist Party chairman, who rushed to Moscow. Stalin berated Gottwald for betraying the communist partnership. Czechoslovakia's leader quickly volunteered to pull out of the Marshall Plan deliberations. When he returned home, Czechoslovakia's government withdrew its stated intention to discuss economic aid with the West. Meanwhile, Czechoslovakia's economic problems continued to mount. In turn, increasingly, Czechoslovak citizens and politicians lost confidence in the communists. It became clear that the party would not do very well in the planned 1948 election. Stalin and Czechoslovakia's communists saw the writing on the wall and decided to act. In February 1948, Stalin sent to Prague one of his top diplomats, Valerian Zorin, whose mere presence offered a reminder that Czechoslovakia's communists had the backing of the Soviet Red Army. To bang home the point, Gottwald requested that Soviet forces set up along Czechoslovakia's border. Stalin also sent consultants to Prague. Following the consultants' blueprint, Czechoslovakia's communists purged critics from the National Police Force and mobilized militias of supporters who took to the streets. Czechoslovakia's non-communist leaders saw no good options. They could risk civil war and possibly a Soviet invasion by pushing back against the communists, or they could give in. People like the Holiks knew little about these behind-the-scenes machinations, but they did know that over the course of February 1948, police and armed militia groups took over Prague and began a purge of all non-communists in the government and the bureaucracy. And they knew that on February 25, 1948, Czechoslovakia's non-communist parties and leaders stepped down, permitting the communists to take full control of the country. In the weeks that followed, the Holiks watched with horror as their new government banned all opposition to the regime and imprisoned non-communist politicians who continued to resist. The one remaining member of the cabinet not sympathetic to the communists was found dead, having jumped out of a third-story window. Within less than 3 years, Czechoslovakia had traded a German occupation for a homegrown, but Soviet-supported, authoritarian regime of its own. Initially, following the coup, the police arrested relatively small numbers of potential dissenters from the military, police, and non-communist political parties, and many of them were soon released. However, in the fall of 1948, the government passed the Law for the Defense of the Republic, which made it a crime to speak ill of Czechoslovakia or its leaders, or even to criticize the Soviet Union. In the coming years, tens of thousands of Czechs and Slovaks would be sentenced to prison for these crimes. The STB, Statni Bezpečnost, the secret police, detained and then released tens and possibly hundreds of thousands more. The secret police also swept thousands of potential opponents out of Czechoslovakia's cities, opposition party leaders, business owners, lawyers, pensioners. Large numbers were sent to labor camps and uranium mines, while their homes were turned over to Communist Party notables. Travel beyond the country's borders without permission became prohibited. The government followed Stalin's cue in calling dissenters the enemies of the people and enemies of the republic. It carried out a purge of teachers who might not be sympathetic to the communist cause. In school, children learned Russian and about both the virtues of communism and the failings of capitalism. Instead of a free press, the media delivered whatever news was useful to the regime. The Ministry of Information and Culture took over and purified the country's libraries and bookstores. More than 14 million books were removed from private collections. The Holiks felt the pressure. On a daily basis, Czechs and Slovaks had every reason to fear the secret police, whose network of informants allowed the government's reach to be everywhere. Throughout the country, co-workers, neighbors, friends, and at times even family members now reported each other's actions and words to the government. The Holik's good friend, Dr. Horníček, often came to the house to talk politics and listen to Radio Free Europe with Jaroslav Sr. so they could learn about the news from abroad. When Viera got angry and closed the windows to make sure no one could hear them, the men turned the volume way down and leaned in close to the receiver. Dr. Horníček insisted, "Look, I'm telling you, within a year it's going to blow up and the communists will be out of power." One day he said those same words in a local cafe and then found himself imprisoned for a year. At home, Jaroslav Sr. and Viera constantly cursed the regime, but the moment they stepped outside, they zipped their mouths shut. The problem they faced, though, was that Jaroslav Jr. had no filter. No matter how much they pleaded, and no matter where he was or whom he was with, the younger Jaroslav never shied away from expressing his views on the communists. Fortunately, his tirades never came back to haunt the family. Perhaps his years of antics had most of the town already turning a blind eye and deaf ear. Following the 1948 coup, Czechoslovakia's communist leaders feared that the USSR might remove them from power and possibly even send in troops if they didn't demonstrate complete loyalty. The government went to great lengths to demonstrate its allegiance to Moscow. "Friendship with the Soviet Union" became a national slogan, and now President Gottwald became the object, although only as a junior partner to Stalin, of a cult of personality pushed across Czechoslovakia. Czechoslovak officials placed portraits of Stalin and Gottwald everywhere, always careful to describe Gottwald as Stalin's best disciple. Work began in Prague on an enormous granite statue of Stalin, some 50 feet high, 70 feet long, and weighing 17,000 tons, the largest depiction of the Soviet leader in the world. In the years 1949 to 52, Stalin sent Soviet advisors to help the Czechoslovak government prove that it was under threat and rally support around the country for the regime. A series of show trials played out, relying on fabricated charges and evidence, including torture-induced confessions. The torture included direct physical pain, as well as sleep deprivation to muddle the defendant's thinking, and threats of devastating consequences for wives and children. The trials were broadcast live over the radio and included an audience that the government bussed in to watch. Everyone followed a script that all the participants, including the charged, were forced to memorize and rehearse. The outcome, always pre-established, included lengthy prison terms and even the death penalty. In the end, some 200 people were executed. Beginning in 1949, the government went after the Catholic Church, which stood as a competitor for the hearts and minds of the working class. The regime seized monasteries. It also imprisoned hundreds, if not thousands, of Catholic priests, monks, and nuns, subjected many to torture and abuse, and in some cases, put them to death. Perhaps the most distressing of the show trials focused on Milada Horakova. Horakova had worked tirelessly as a social justice and women's rights activist. When she campaigned in favor of democracy and in opposition to the communists after the 1948 coup, the government arrested her as the criminal mastermind of a terrorist conspiracy. In late spring 1950, Horakova's trial was broadcast not just on the radio, but also through public address systems in workplaces and in the streets. Even after brutal torture by the secret police, the 48-year-old Horakova refused to follow the script and calmly disputed the charges. But the court found her guilty and sentenced her to death. On June 27, 1950, the government hanged her. Still, many in the country believed in the communist system. To them, it was kinder than capitalism, which left those at the bottom defenseless. Supporters rejoiced in May 1948 when a new constitution declared that the economy would be founded on nationalized industry and the government began to take over privately owned businesses. Vera's father, Robert Horak, was one of those people who believed deeply in the idea of communism. He loved the idea of a society and government that would take care of everyone. Grandpa Horak volunteered as the head of the local homeless shelter. He got up at 4 a.m. every day to walk 3 miles to the train station to pick up a large stack of Rude Pravo, the Communist Party's newspaper, which he then distributed around town. Even at a very young age, Yaroslav Jr. recognized the extraordinary kindness of his grandfather and decided that if he ever had a son, he would name him Robert. When it came to communism, Grandpa Horak and Yaroslav Sr. totally disagreed. The communists' actions directly threatened the Holiks' lives. Yaroslav Sr. and Vera spent 1949 moving from a state of disbelief to growing unease to downright fear and misery as the government gradually took control of Havlíčkův Brod's establishments. In 1948-49, the regime nationalized all of Brod's large textile factories and seized local Brod farms, which it transferred to state farm collectives. At first, the government assured the people of Czechoslovakia that it would only take over businesses with at least 50 employees. But over time, it extended its reach to smaller and smaller ones as well. The Holiks feared for their cannery, but felt safe in their butcher shop, which employed only a few workers. Then they watched in horror as the government moved in on the shops of small craftsmen and even took over the one-man barber shop in town. One night in 1950, the Holiks' smokehouse burned down when an employee fell asleep on the job. The government used the fire as an excuse, blaming the Holiks for sabotaging the national economy and harming a workplace of the people. It gave Yaroslav Sr. two options. He could accept a tiny sum of cash in exchange for the entire business, or the government could simply take the business from the Holiks and send Yaroslav Sr. to jail. Yaroslav Sr. agreed to the sale, but he remained optimistic. Surely the communist government would soon fall and he would get his business back. But his hopes never materialized. Every day offered a painful reminder to the Holiks of how their world had been turned upside down. They continued to live at the butchery, only the shop wasn't theirs anymore. They had lost, or rather the communists had taken, everything. To make ends meet, Yaroslav Sr. faced the possibility of working in the mines, until some friends helped him get a job at the brickwork factory. As he took up the new position, life for the Holiks took an even worse turn when Viera fell severely ill with tuberculosis. The family lived in constant fear as she spent the next 2 years in and out of the hospital. To compensate, Yaroslav Sr. picked up a side job of sifting sand. Gradually, Viera recovered, and after a few years, she and her husband took over the management of a fast food establishment. They made the business a success, but their shifts were 12 hours a day, and one of them had to be there most days. Still, their situation was tolerable compared to what some people were facing. Throughout his life, Yaroslav Jr. would vividly remember the most startling show trial, one making it crystal clear that no one was safe in Czechoslovakia. In 1951, following instructions from the highest levels in Moscow, the Soviet advisors insisted that Czechoslovakia investigate and put on trial leading members of the country's Communist Party. The authorities arrested as many as 25,000 members of the party, government, military, and security forces, and employees in nearly every sector of the economy. At first, the investigators arrested only minor figures, but increasingly over time, they fabricated evidence against far bigger fish. On December 6, 1951, President Gottwald announced that they had found proof that his top deputy and the second most powerful figure in the country, General Secretary Rudolf Slansky, the man who had helped kickstart Czechoslovakia's show trials, was leading a conspiracy against the party and the state. Nearly 1 year later, on November 27, 1952, Slansky's trial produced 14 guilty verdicts. 11 of the men, including Slansky, were Jewish, hardly surprising given the heavy anti-Semitism that was part of the 1950s purges. Slansky was publicly hanged on December 3rd. Yaroslav Sr. invited friends who shared his hatred of the communists to come sit around his giant dining room table and listen to the radio broadcast of the Slansky trial. Following a behind-the-scenes barrage of mental and physical torture, Slansky confessed to the totally fabricated crimes and willingly followed the government's script. The men around the table exclaimed, "How could anyone confess to so many things? The people are being swindled." Yaroslav Jr. sat with them and listened to every word. As he did, the 10-year-old boy thought to himself, "This country is sick." Chapter 2: Enormous Fish on a Tiny Pond. When his kids were little, Yaroslav Sr. decided to make them into ski jumpers. He drove them some 25 miles to Harush Hill, where they marched to the top of a 100-foot ramp. From there, he could see the path to stardom. Then he looked at the boys. Terrified little Yiri sobbed, begging not to have to jump. It probably wasn't going to work with that one. Yaroslav Sr. turned toward his firstborn and told him to begin. Yaroslav Jr. was iron-willed, never willing to admit fear. But his stomach now churned unpleasantly. He tried not to look at the ground far below, and he pushed off. He instantly felt his body sucked downward at an unimaginable speed before dropping off the bottom lip of the ramp and immediately crashed onto his face. Down on the ground, he lay in a crumpled heap. "Again," Yaroslav Sr. barked at the boy. Yaroslav Jr. made his way back up the ramp and initiated his second descent. Same result. "Again!" Before long, the futility of these efforts dawned on the man. His sons were not going to become ski jumpers. Plus, it was just too much work to reach the mountains. Yaroslav Sr. relished the fact that his boys lived a life similar to kids in free countries all around the world. But he also believed that their freedom and joy would be fleeting. Before long, Yaroslav Jr. and Yiri would be grown, and life for the average citizen in Czechoslovakia was difficult. The government had taken away his business. Basic products like fruit, vegetables, meat, and appliances were in short supply. People had to wait in lines for everything, and often couldn't get what they wanted. In a communist society, very few forms of upward mobility existed. The most straightforward path to a better life was to join the Communist Party and work one's way up within its ranks. Yet the notion of joining the group that had taken away his butcher shop made the Holik paterfamilias sick to his core. But there was one other way to succeed in a communist society: sports. It was a long shot, but he became convinced that between him and his boys, they could make it happen. During the Cold War, Eastern Bloc governments placed a big emphasis on sports. They regularly highlighted their own athletes and teams, whose success created a distraction from the difficulties of daily life, inspired in their people a sense of pride in the country, and, when victorious, showed the world the superiority of the communist system. For these reasons, communist regimes gave their athletes favored status, allowing them benefits that few others in the country received. They got better pay, greater access to food and luxury items, like cars, and first crack at services such as good schooling and housing. And they were among the very few to be able to travel to lands outside the communist world. Athletes in Czechoslovakia were no exception. At the very moment that Yaroslav Sr. looked to begin training his boys, he could see all this in the life of Emil Zatopek. In the 1940s and 50s, Zatopek was the finest long-distance runner in the world, at a time in which track and field stood out as one of the most popular sports on the globe. Combined with his naturally ebullient and warm personality, Zatopek's success made him the most popular athlete in Czechoslovakia. Born in 1922 in Czechoslovakia, Zatopek was a true believer in communism. He embraced the equality that communism purported to create and openly supported Czechoslovakia's government. In the 1950s, he would cooperate with the military counterintelligence branch of the secret police. In 1950, his signature even appeared on a letter that endorsed the execution of Milada Horakova, although there is debate over whether he had actually agreed to attach his name. The communist regime took full advantage of Zatopek's athletic achievements in its propaganda efforts. As Zatopek set one world record after another, the government-sponsored newspaper placed his accomplishments on the front page, citing it as proof of the greatness of the country's administration of sports. In the 1948 Summer Olympics, Zatopek won a gold and a silver medal. Upon his return after the Games, the government organized victory parades for the hero and sent him around the country to give morale-boosting speeches to workers' groups. Because Zatopek brought glory to the country, he also had unique latitude to push back against the regime. While at the 1948 Olympics, Zatopek met a Czechoslovak javelin thrower named Dana Ingrova, and the two fell in love. As a member of the military, Zatopek had to seek permission from the army to get married. But his request was quickly rejected because Dana's godfather had been associated with the country's pre-1948 democratic regime. When Zatopek announced that he would therefore quit the military, the army did an about-face and consented to the marriage. In 1952, Zatopek's friend Stanislav Jungwirth won Czechoslovakia's 1500-meter track championship, thus qualifying to run the event in the Olympics in Helsinki, Finland. But Jungwirth's father was in prison, jailed for political dissidence, so Czechoslovakia's authorities informed their 1500-meter champion that he would not be permitted to travel to Finland. Furious at the poor treatment of his fellow athlete, Zatopek refused to get on the airplane that was to carry the team, informing officials that he would only go if Jungwirth did as well. Czechoslovakia's officials blinked and agreed to send both men. Zatopek knew the potential trouble he was in. Even under normal circumstances, he told friends that he feared imprisonment if he failed in athletic competitions. Now that he had directly taken on the regime, many assumed that anything less than a celebrated performance would lead Zatopek to a sentence of hard labor in the uranium mines. Indeed, a document proposing the exemplary punishment of Staff Captain Emil Zatopek was delivered to the defense minister's inbox. Ordinarily, Zatopek ran only the 5,000 and 10,000-meter races at the Olympics. Now, though, to give himself a greater chance of winning gold, he added an event that he had never run before, the marathon. Over the course of 8 days, Zatopek won gold in all three events, each in Olympic record time. The defense ministry tore up the document that had proposed his punishment. Back in Havlíčkův Brod, Jaroslav Holík Sr. was unaware of how Zatopek had asserted his independence, but he knew that he wanted his children to have the same opportunities Emil had. Jaroslav Sr. had always been deeply involved in sports. His great love had been skiing, especially ski jumping, and he had trained with one of the country's legendary jumpers. As an adult, with a wife and family, though, he had thrown himself into his butcher shop and insisted that his boys help the business succeed. But when the government took the shop, there wasn't any point to having the kids come to work with him anymore. Instead, they would become athletic stars. He told them time and again, "If you want to get anywhere in life, you have to play a sport. It won't happen any other way." It became his obsession. In the town of Havlíčkův Brod, in the country of Czechoslovakia, the obvious sport was hockey. By the early 1950s, Czechoslovakia already had a rich but sometimes troubling history with hockey. Organized hockey, in its current form, with a flat, circular puck, was codified and became popular in Canada in the last decades of the 19th century. Meanwhile, Europe focused on its own version of the sport, bandy, in which players made big golf swings at a round ball. Bandy soon attracted a healthy following in Prague, in what was then called Bohemia, Czech lands within the Austro-Hungarian Empire. In the early 1900s, though, the popularity of the Canadian style of the game grew rapidly in Europe, and in 1908, a group of European countries founded what was to become the International Ice Hockey Federation, IIHF. Bohemia was among the early members. In 1909, Bohemia sent a Canadian-style hockey team to to its first ever international tournament in Chamonix, France. Just a few weeks before the tournament, the team's goalie, a gynecologist by profession, sat down to translate the rules of the game from French into Czech. But an issue remained. The players from Bohemia had never actually played the game. On the train ride to France, a Belgian passenger showed them a puck, the first one they had ever seen. They were surprised by the shape, having thought until then that hockey pucks were square. When they arrived in France, they had to buy Canadian-style hockey sticks, suitable for playing with a puck, because such sticks didn't exist in Bohemia. Not surprisingly, Bohemia lost every game it played. Despite the losses, the men returned home excited about the game and eager to compete more. But they faced a new problem: ice, or more accurately, the lack thereof. In most years, Prague sees little snow and infrequent freezing temperatures. With no ice in Prague in 1910, the team found itself unable to practice. So it didn't attend the inaugural European Hockey Championships in Switzerland. In 1911, the climate proved more helpful until 3 weeks before the tournament, when the Prague ice melted. Unwilling to miss out again, the men created a makeshift rink, where they laid down pieces of waxed wood boards on which they practiced shooting goals. Improbably, the approach worked. The team traveled to Berlin, where it won the European Championships. With the victory, Bohemians went wild over the sport. By 1913, Bohemia had the most hockey clubs in Europe and became a European hockey powerhouse until World War I halted international play. Once the games returned in the 1920s, the team from the newly minted Czechoslovakia remained one of the best in Europe, although it didn't hold a candle to squads from Canada. During World War II, hockey served a surprising role in the Czech lands, helping maintain the spirit of the people in the face of an otherwise all-powerful foe. In 1940, Germany organized a pair of matches between its own players and those of the occupied Czech region. The plan was to highlight Aryan superiority in sports for propaganda purposes. And accordingly, the games were broadcast live over the radio to tens of thousands of civilians from a Prague stadium where most of the spectators were German soldiers. But things didn't go as planned for the Germans. The Czechs won 5-1 and 3-0. After the war ended, the sport became a joyful outlet for the people of Czechoslovakia. The national hockey team was aided by the fact that its players had been forced to stay in the country, where they had plenty of opportunity to play. Indeed, during the war, the leading teams played games as often as 5 times a week in exchange for food, one of the most sought-after commodities in occupied Europe. The first ice hockey world championships after the war were held in 1947 in Prague as the country tried to rebuild. In those days, children went to school 6 days a week, and because the tournament began on a Saturday, ordinarily they would have been unable to attend. But a coal shortage made it impossible to heat the local schools an extra day, leaving hundreds of children free to watch the opening matches. When Sweden defeated Czechoslovakia 2-1 near the end of the round-robin tournament, it was assumed that all was lost for the home country team. The following day, Sweden was matched up against Austria, and a victory by the Swedes would clinch the title. With defeat assuredly at hand, hundreds of Czechoslovakia fans chose to ignore the game and instead attended an afternoon production of The Barber of Seville. To their surprise, in the opera's final act, a well-informed but still in-character performer sang, "Say to the master that Austria is beating Sweden," inspiring mad cheering among the audience. Austria held on to defeat Sweden, which meant that Czechoslovakia had won its first ice hockey world championship. Given that ice only really stayed on the ground for around 4 months per year, Czechoslovakia didn't have the climate to favor winter sports. But the 1947 world title cemented the country's love of the game played on frozen water with sticks and a flat puck. However, the championship had a large asterisk attached to it because Canada, winner of 11 of the 13 pre-war world championships, had chosen not to attend in 1947. Returning to world action in 1948, it made its presence known in the Winter Olympics in St. Moritz, Switzerland. In their one game against each other, Canada and Czechoslovakia tied. The two countries finished the Olympics with identical 7-0-1, 7 wins, 0 losses, and 1 tie, records. But Canada was awarded the gold medal because of its greater goal differential, the margin by which it had outscored its opponents. 2 weeks after Czechoslovakia's ice hockey team returned from the 1948 games, the communists carried out their coup. Rather than live under a communist regime, thousands of Czechs and Slovaks fled the country. In turn, the government imposed strict limits on travel. But the communists recognized that allowing some movement out of the country could be beneficial. Czechoslovak athletes who performed well in international competition would promote national pride at home and demonstrate the superiority of the country's sports program. As such, it was important to permit athletes to compete abroad. But the regime also grew worried over what they might do once they left the country's borders. In November 1948, Czechoslovakia's national hockey squad was slated to play a series of exhibition matches in England. The Czechoslovak players split up into two different airplanes. The first group left the continent a day early and then waited for their remaining teammates, who were supposed to come to London the next day. Game time arrived, but the rest of the team didn't. Later that night, those in London received the news. The air taxi carrying the remaining players had disappeared from radar over the English Channel. The men aboard had almost certainly perished. The plane crash crushed morale, but hockey had become so popular in 1940s Czechoslovakia that the country retained a large pool of players. Just 3 months later, a reconstituted Czechoslovak squad traveled to Stockholm, Sweden, to participate in the 1949 World Ice Hockey Championships. Opening the final round of play, the team defeated Canada to take the gold medal, inspiring wild celebrations back in Czechoslovakia. By now, though, Czechoslovakia's communist regime had grown paranoid about its athletes. After Zatopek, Czechoslovakia's greatest athlete at the time was Jaroslav Drobny. Drobny had been a star on Czechoslovakia's national hockey team. He was also ranked among the top tennis players in the world, and in 1949 quit hockey to focus on tennis. Grateful for the prestige he brought the country, Czechoslovak officials prepared to bestow upon him the title Master of Sport, which carried with it a lifetime pension. Ironically, as they finalized the honor, Drobny defected from Czechoslovakia, terrified of how easily the government could take everything away from him. The regime temporarily imprisoned innocent friends of Drobny's as punishment for his departure and prohibited other tennis players from leaving Czechoslovakia at all for the next 5 years. An easy-to-miss plaque on a city wall in Prague makes clear just how far the government was willing to go to prevent further escapes by its athletes. The bronze plaque bears the image of a hockey player and an inscription noting that the three-story building there was once a tavern, the spot where tragedy befell players from Czechoslovakia's beloved team. In March 1950, the national hockey team arrived at Prague's airport, where it was to board a flight to London, this time to defend its world title. But abruptly, the authorities announced that the trip was delayed and the team should go home to await further instructions. Perhaps the players should have been suspicious. Just days before, Elena Vrizanova, Czechoslovakia's top figure skater, had decided not to return to Czechoslovakia after winning her second consecutive World Ladies Singles title in London, and the regime was obviously concerned that more athletes might defect as well. On March 13th, Czechoslovak officials informed the players that the trip to London was cancelled because, they said, the British had not provided visas for Czechoslovakia's radio reporters. The entire story sounded fishy. Devastated, a number of the players headed to the Uherzliku Tavern in Prague to drown their sorrows. As they drank, they grew boisterous, ranting against the Communist Party. Soon a fight broke out between the players and some other men, who turned out to be members of the secret police who arrested them all. The players assumed that the jailing was simply because of the bar fight and that everything would soon return to normal, but events took a very different turn. Before long, the police arrested other members of the team who had not been at the pub, including goalie Bohumil Modrý. The authorities announced that the players were state traitors who had planned to defect from Czechoslovakia and that Modrý was the ringleader of the planned escape. Since the communists had taken power in 1948, the punishment for those considering defection had been meted out to thousands of people in the country. First, torture. Police commonly bound, blindfolded, and stripped the accused naked. The inquisitors then beat those they had captured and even sicked attack dogs on them. They routinely burned their captives and stuck needles under their fingernails. The accused typically confessed and then were sent to prison, often for many years, often in the country's uranium mines, where they worked with little protective gear, choked on radioactive dust, and used radioactive water for tea. As the police explained the case before them, the hockey players were flabbergasted. They had pondered defecting in 1948, but ultimately had chosen not to do so. As the players awaited trial, the jailers tortured them. One well-known official, Captain Pergel, used whips and batons, and even an apparatus that he attached to the accused temples and then tightened. The outcome of the trial was preordained. 12 players in all were found guilty, with sentences ranging from 8 months to 15 years. Modrý received the harshest sentence, 15 years hard labor in the Yakimov mines. There, prisoners dug up and carried uranium barehanded, which was then sent to the Soviet Union for the country's nuclear program. After 5 years, Modrý was released, but the time working with radiation took its toll, and he died at age 46. To this day, no one knows for certain what the regime hoped to achieve by imprisoning the players. The most convincing explanation is that the authorities arrested the men simply for their behavior at the pub, but once they were in custody, the secret police realized that the event could be used to their advantage. Concerned about a wave of defections, they decided to send a message to the people. No one was beyond the reach of the government, not even star athletes, and even considering defection would be punished. Despite the imprisonment of the national team, Czechoslovakia remained obsessed with the sport of hockey, nowhere more so than in Havlíčkův Brod. In part, the townspeople loved the sport because there was little else to do. Only a few families in Brod had a telephone. The only television in town was at the hospital, and even that was really more of a radio with a tiny screen. The Holiks owned a radio and a gramophone, and Jaroslav Sr. had a few vinyl records that he liked to play. For teenagers, there was no place to go dancing or listen to music, just tea times, essentially a cafe or restaurant where teen boys could drink tea and glance awkwardly at girls. Adults didn't have many options outside the house either. They could go to one of the pubs or an occasional movie, but that was it. Brod's greatest living legend was a hockey player named Václav Chytráček, who was the only player in town good enough to make a full-time living off the sport. When Chytráček skated, he looked like he was floating and appeared to be able to do anything imaginable with a hockey stick. He often grabbed a puck behind his own goal, skated up the ice, and scored all on his own. The people of Brod loved him when he was briefly appointed to play for the National B squad, essentially the backup national team. They worshipped him when he declined offers to join top league teams because of his desire to stay in his hometown. And his legend only grew after he took a stick to the face, leaving him blind in one eye, but still continued to play and run every aspect of the Brod men's team. With the town's love of hockey, and seeing Chytráček as inspiration, Jaroslav Sr. made his decision. His boys would become hockey stars. After he lost his business and thought about how he would stay afloat financially, Jaroslav Sr. told those around him his plan.
"I have two small boys, and I want them to be athletes. I won't go work in the mines, but I will work in the brickworks so I can keep an eye on my kids."
Despite the enthusiasm for hockey in Brod, the youth hockey team was basically a ragtag group of a dozen kids with makeshift equipment and mismatched jerseys who were willing to get up at unspeakable hours to play. They didn't exactly attend rigorous practices. Occasionally, Chytráček came to coach. On those days, the boys learned a bit about hockey tactics and training. But most days, the boys' practices at Kotlina looked a lot like their unstructured play on the pond. They skated for a while, and when they felt ready, they played practice games. With only about a dozen kids there, everyone played, giving them all a chance to hone their skills. In addition to Dad Tomanek, one other adult was willing to coach, Jaroslav Sr. Like Tomanek, Holik rarely set foot on the ice and didn't even have a pair of skates. Mostly, he just told the boys how long to skate and then threw them some pucks. Despite knowing relatively little about the sport, he constantly criticized their play, and his highest praise was,
"That was weak but passable."
He focused on keeping his players disciplined. he took greater charge at games, where he roared before every match, "Score 5 goals in the first 5 minutes, and you're good to go." Then, if the boys went more than a few minutes without a goal, he berated them, "You jackasses! How come you didn't score again?" When the boys were victorious, Yaroslav Sr. insisted they could do even better, informing them that they had only won by a little. It became clear that his boys and Suhi were a cut above the rest, and once Jan's father agreed to it, Yaroslav Sr. was tough on all three. If Yaroslav Sr. was unhappy with any of his three young stars, smack. Yaroslav Jr., of course, argued ferociously with everyone everywhere. At home, Yaroslav Sr. didn't use corporal punishment to deal with his elder son's impertinence, but he never hesitated to strike him at the rink, especially when the boy talked back to him. During one match, Yaroslav Jr. tore into Jiri, telling the younger boy that he was causing them to lose the game. Their father grew so incensed that he chased young Yaroslav around the ice and only stopped when the referee came to the rescue. Yet, no matter how he acted with them on the ice, the former butcher felt incredible pride in his children's hockey prowess. After games, when he knew the boys couldn't hear him, he exulted to his wife, "Vyarushka, our boys crushed it on ice today." Coming from a small town without public transportation, the greatest adventure for the boys was getting to travel to other towns to play. Dad Tomanek was a skilled organizer and set up matches all around the region. Even just traveling 25 miles out of town felt like a huge trip. And going to the big city of Prague, it was like visiting a strange new land. The boys usually went by train, but the most exciting trips were taken in the backs of flatbed trucks. For the whole wintry drive, they lay down on a bed of fur underneath a tarp. Victory always made the freezing cold worth it. Whenever the boys won, Tomanek bought them all hot dogs. In their memories, they were the most delicious that they would ever taste. Yaroslav Jr. instantly became the team's undisputed leader, a position he partly maintained by beating up any teammate who didn't follow his instructions. As old-timer and the boss on the ice, Yaroslav was a natural center forward, the player in the middle of all the action. But even though Yaroslav was better than most kids at most aspects of hockey, he was not an especially good skater or shooter. It was other, less tangible features of Yaroslav's game that made him special. He was an indefatigably hard worker with total control of the stick, a creative mind, and an ability to see possible moves no one else could. Even as a youngster, he came up with unexpected and productive passes to his teammates. He never stopped fighting for the puck, no matter what the score or the time remaining in the game. In any match he played, he waged a constant stream of battles with his opponents and the referees. He even drove his own teammates crazy with his constant criticism. He especially fought with Jiri and Suhi when he thought they had made poor passes. Jiri had a completely different style. With his exceptional natural skating ability, he could elegantly do anything he liked on the ice, even when moving at top speed. And with his great instincts, he always seemed to end up in the right spot to make a play work. He was also so fast that few opponents could keep up with him, making him a constant threat on offense. With that speed, he was one of those rare offensive players who could rush back on defense when needed. As soon as he did, he grabbed the puck and started a new offensive set, which usually began with the pass to his brother. The two Holik boys scarcely interacted off the ice, not even saying good night as they turned off the light in their shared room. During the freezing winter months, though, the boys spent hours every day together at the rink, and usually played side by side on the offensive line. They balanced each other, in part because of their different but complementary skills. They fought constantly, but their years of focusing on trying to win, rather than on their own individual glory, allowed each to know instinctively what the other would do and made it possible to play completely in sync. The boys' personalities played well off each other, too. Born into a family where his older brother and father sucked all the oxygen out of the room, Yiri never tried to be a leader. His cheerful presence acted as a counterweight to his over-the-top brother. Surprisingly, despite his upbeat personality, Yiri quickly became dejected when his team started to lose. If the team fell behind by even just one goal early in the game, Yiri glowered, "This is going to suck!" Yaroslav fumed at what he saw as his brother quitting, but usually the older boy's intensity fired Yiri back up. Even though Yaroslav Jr. drove his parents crazy, his father seemed to favor him over his younger brother. Yaroslav Sr. valued hard work above all else, and no one worked harder than his elder son. As a result, he was more likely to talk about the accomplishments of Yaroslav Jr., no matter how well Yiri did. Nevertheless, Yaroslav Sr. always sought to keep both boys' egos in check. When Yaroslav Jr. was 11, a sports magazine published a beautiful picture of him scoring a backhand goal after faking out the goalie in a big tournament in Prague. Viera could hardly contain her pride. But Yaroslav Sr. told his son, "Only when you win a world championship can you say that you know how to play hockey." Unlike the Holiks on the offensive forward line, Jan Suchy positioned himself as a defenseman, even as a six-year-old. He had an extremely physical style, body-checking offensive players who came into his zone and throwing himself into would-be shots by his opponents. However, whenever he got the puck near his own goal, he totally disregarded the coach's instructions to stay back on defense and instead charged up the ice trying to score. When he joined the forwards in their attack, Yiri and Yaroslav yelled at him, "Why the hell are you up here?" Unlike most who played his position, Suchy had amazing control over the puck. He didn't shoot with much power, but once he got near the goal, he could aim with stunning precision. He scored a lot, unusual for a defensive player. Coaches couldn't control Jan's decision to go on the offensive, and once they saw how well it worked, they gave up trying to stop him. By the time the boys were teenagers, hockey took up many hours a day, to the point that it created conflicts with school. It didn't help that Yaroslav and Suchy scarcely put any effort into their schoolwork. Most of the teachers were unimpressed with the boys' hockey prowess and weren't happy with their academic performance and frequent tardiness after getting back late from games. As the older one, the issue with school reared its head first for Yaroslav. Around the age of 14, students in Czechoslovakia who did well in the classroom could continue on to gymnasium, the standard academically oriented schools. Students who did poorly would have to briefly attend a vocational school and then get a full-time job. In Yaroslav's cohort, only 90 students would get to continue on the academic school path. And Yaroslav and two of his buddies ranked 91st, 92nd, and 93rd. Yaroslav Sr. grew deeply worried. He knew firsthand how hard life was for the average working person in Czechoslovakia and what a full-time job would mean.
"You must go to school, because only then will you have time for hockey."
In the end, though, Yaroslav Jr. lucked out. At the last moment, a few of the top 90 students chose to forego the local academic school path, creating space for the troublesome Holik boy. Though academic doors were rapidly closing, it became increasingly clear that the boys of Brod could play hockey at a very, very high level. The town had a population at the time of only around 15,000 people, in contrast to the roughly 1 million who lived in Prague. The size of the hockey teams reflected this disparity. Brod's team had 2 goalies and around 10 skaters, about half what the various city teams put forward. As they lined up to face each other prior to games, the other team's roster stretched the width of the ice, while the Holiks, Suchy and company barely filled up the middle. In addition, when the Brod boys showed up for games, the opposing team's supporters laughed at them. Kids from Prague hit the ice in beautiful new ironed uniforms. The Brod boys often came wearing whatever they could find and have their mothers mend for them. It was a treat when Yiri and Suhi were in 8th grade and the Brod organizers got the boys matching green and white Brod jerseys. But the crowd still mocked them for their mismatched pants. Despite, or perhaps because of, its disadvantages, the team bonded. The boys instinctively learned to play in constant motion, always aware of where their teammates were on the ice, but leaving opponents uncertain how to cover them. Hockey teams typically send out to the ice 1 goalie, 3 forwards, and 2 defensemen. Because hockey is so exhausting, most teams frequently cycle in new lines of skaters so players can get regular breaks. But with only 10 or so on the Brod team, the Holiks and Suhi rarely rested at all during games. It was remarkable that Suhi could handle it. When he was 11 years old, he had decided that he wanted to start smoking, but couldn't afford the cigarettes. A buddy of his, the son of a shop owner, suggested a way. They would take empty bottles out of the shop and then bring them back to the store, saying they had collected them around town in exchange for money to buy cigarettes. By 13, Suhi was smoking regularly and drinking beer.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.